Previously on Up at Noon.
Greg, are you watching that stupid-ass Metal Gear Solid trailer again? This thing is so dumb, it's like an hour long and nothing happens.
Brian, it is amazing. You have to watch it.
I just shit myself.
Why do you think I haven't been able to move?
Hey guys, what are you watching? Oh, Metal Gear. Oh my god.
Like, just when you thought the bar couldn't get lower, there it goes. What's up, everybody? I'm Greg Miller. Welcome to Up at Noon. Please give it up for Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes. We won it. Would have loved to have made fun of the trailer, but every time we watched it, we just got quiet and very happy about the future of video games. We actually found we have real feelings. As always, please subscribe to start, like this video, and leave a comment below. If you think we don't listen to those comments, ask viewers like Matthew Smith. He asked us to have Borderlands 2 Randy Pitchford on the show. And guess what? I said, all right, Matthew Smith, Borderlands 2 Randy Pitchford. He's here this week. He's the interview. Borderlands 2. Oh my gosh. Sadly, we've also got three idiots talking about the Ninja Turtles box set and a request about the Oculus Rift. But first, the news you care about. A new Kickstarter project hopes to make a coffee table book based on Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. It's a great conversation starter if you never want your conversations to end in sex. Charlie Sheen has said that when he was younger, he was considered to play Spider-Man. Unfortunately, before that could happen, he was bitten by a radioactive crazy asshole. The complete DVD box set of the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is coming this fall. And the moment I get it, so am I. Skeet, skeet. Scientists are saying the common skin disease known as rosacea may be caused by mites dying and defecating in the pores of your skin. There's no joke here. This is just a reminder that life is a nightmare. A hacker has released a video of him emulating Crash Team Racing on the Nook. Not to be outdone, I emulated Dead or Alive on my calculator. Boobies! Thank you very much. High class show this week. 22 whales were beached off of Florida's coast, proving that even whales know the only thing Florida is good for is going there to die. Florida sucks. Get over it. How many elections do you have to ruin? Madden 13 sold 900,000 copies in its first day. You said to your dad in an attempt to talk about video games? Square Enix has announced they're further expanding the Final Fantasy XIII series with the game Lightning Returns Final Fantasy XIII. They came up with the name after fans rejected the longer, original title, Lightning Returns. We're driving the Final Fantasy series straight into the ground and we can't stop because money is like crack. Gaten. Now, as we mentioned earlier, the complete original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles cartoon is coming to DVD this fall. Here with a very serious discussion on what that means is Mike Drucker, Brian Altano, Anthony Gallegos. We call it Turtle Talk.
What's up, everyone? Anthony, Brian, and Mike here to talk about this really stupid Ninja Turtles box set.
What?
It's not stupid at all.
I don't get it. I don't understand it. This is $100.
So what?
$100.
How much did you spend? How much have you spent on Star Wars yesterday?
That is a point, but the thing about it is that Star Wars is like this universe that's been grown over the years, and it tells like this really great story that I think is like timeless for humans. You know, it's like a good and evil battle.
What?
And I'm hold on, and you guys want to watch 23 discs of giant reptiles eating trash.
First of all, pizza's not trash. The Ninja Turtles lore is just as important as anything in Star Wars.
Oh yeah, I definitely forgot about how important it was that there was a rat that learned kung fu by sitting in a cage.
I was a teenager once, decades ago. I identify with this shit. I don't identify with Alderaan getting blown up and my whole family dying.
There's 73 hours of this.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Wait a minute, you were a teenager when you watched the Ninja Turtles? I was like 7.
All right, so whatever. It's just the way this thing goes, okay? That's why I'm excited for this box set to come out, because I think part of me will always be a teenager.
But I don't,
should be 7.
Just for clarification, both of you are in relationships, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where are you planning on putting this?
Right in between us.
I just don't understand how I'm the one not getting laid this time. Like, normally I get it.
Head over to Amazon.com.
So it's $100, but you can pre-order.
How many episodes are there? That's the important part.
There are 193.
Right. Do you know what that is?
193 episodes of them recycling the same dumbass plotline.
That's 193 terrible days you can have where you can go home, hit play, and hear the theme song that brought me through my childhood, adolescence, and teenage years. No matter how bad it is, I can fail 8 tests, get my ass kicked on the bus, and come home and be like, oh man, that f***ing sucked. And hit play, and it's like, Teenage Mutant, and they bust out of the sewer, and I got my first erection. It was amazing. It's amazing.
This just reminds you of all the times that your dumbass went out in the backyard with like 2 sticks, and you were like, I have nunchucks.
Yeah, it was great.
That was the best times of my life.
But I didn't understand, though.
Back when you thought you could still be something.
When I was alone.
That show was great. People were like, oh man, it doesn't hold up. The f*** does that mean it doesn't hold up? It didn't hold up back then either. It didn't make sense.
So why do you want to pay $100
for it? Because it's
great. Amazing.
Every episode's a total surprise. Like this week, they're like, oh man, we got to fight this crazy man that lives in the sewer. He's covered in condoms and dirt. he's a rat.
That's
like episode 840. He's a king of rats. You're like, I don't even understand that. That makes no sense.
Remember Wrecking Rats? Remember?
Yep.
But so it comes in this gigantic van thing.
Right, that's the best
a van
part.
Thing? It's called a party van.
The point of making of it, though, is that it comes in this van thing, but I don't get it. Like, what's the point of the van? It doesn't work.
Because it gets them around the city.
Jesus Christ.
They can't fly.
Yeah, I don't know.
How do you think they're going to get around the city unnoticed?
I'm the type of person that their desk is covered with toys. Like I nerd out about a lot of Star Wars stuff, but when it comes to Ninja Turtles, like that is like, you know, when I stopped being a child, I put my childish crap away.
You didn't stop being a child. You have toys all over your desk. You just admitted it. And if I said to you, oh, why does Luke Skywalker need an X-wing? Why doesn't he just f***ing walk?
That's because they traveled through space.
But he could use like a force bubble.
Turtles travel through time.
They travel through New York, which is even crazier than space.
Yeah, they travel through time as well, which is another great thing. Luke Skywalker never traveled through time.
Yeah, tell me the news team that followed the Star Wars people around. Nobody cared. There's no April O'Neil of the Star Wars universe because nobody gave a shit about any of that.
Right.
Oh, tonight on the news, a guy has a giant beast in his basement, and if people don't dance right, he drops him in, they have to eat it. Nobody's going to watch that on the news. That's the worst episode of the news ever.
Well,
you know what's the best episode of the news ever? 4 turtles had to fight a robot version of themselves.
Wait, time.
Boom.
To be totally fair to Anthony in Star Wars, a man having a monster in his basement that he fed dancers to would be a great news story. Yeah.
All right. You guys can all collect your 23 discs of trash when it comes out really soon. And that's all we got for you. That was 4 minutes that you'll never get back.
Goodbye!
Turtle Talk!
Thanks, Brian and Mike and Anthony, for whatever the hell that was. Speaking of whatever, Greg Wade, I'm dropping whatever I'm doing September 18th to play Borderlands 2. Here to explain why you should too is Gearbox's Randy Pitchford. Woo! It's like live and breathe! Randy Pitchford. How you doing, Randy?
Doing great. How are you doing?
I am excellent. Good job on the jackets.
You know, this is all my wife.
If
I was left to dress myself, I would be wearing like misfitting game t-shirts that I got from conventions, shorts, sandals. It would be a mess.
Yeah.
My wife dresses me.
Yeah. Mike Drucker pulls me together before the show.
Oh, so all right.
It all works out.
Right on.
Exciting times for you. Borderlands 2.
Yes,
coming up right here.
It's very exciting.
Yeah, September 18th, right around the corner. Yeah. Before we get into that, what were you thinking with this Duke Nukem Forever?
What do you mean?
What? Like, it was one of those things, we haven't talked about it, and like, you Duke Nukem wasn't going to happen forever, and then you guys came and you saved it and you put it out.
Yes.
Why did you want to do that? It was Duke Nukem. It was like, eh.
Yeah, but it's not, it's the Duke. Let me tell you, I'm much happier living in a world where Duke is alive and not dead.
Okay. I can live with that. I mean, that's fine. Like, I try to save a whole bunch of failing things too.
And if and if we had to be the ones to resuscitate him and make sure he could live to save us from the aliens.
Aliens one more time?
Yeah.
Is that something you'd want to keep going? I mean, you guys came in late on that project. It wasn't like Gearbox was developing it.
When 3D Realms went away, it was really, it was in 2009 when the word came down that they had shut their doors and that everyone had been laid off. And that was like a sad day. You know, I moved to Texas back in 95 or 6 to join the Duke Nukem 3D team. And that Duke Nukem 3D was like the first commercial product I was ever involved in.
Yeah.
So my friends were over there working on the game. They've been working on it for a dozen years. That was a sad day, man.
Sure.
This is a bummer. So, I think we at the studio, we kind of felt like, there was like a dying patient and we just happened to be the doctor in the house. So like, you're not just gonna let the patient die, you know? And the thing is, when I went in there and I looked at it, it's like, it's a beautiful patient.
this dying patient's beautiful.
No, Duke is one of a kind. There's no character like him in the industry, and he's larger than life. And I played the content that they had made, and I had a lot of fun with it. And there was things that I did in that game that I've never done in a video game before, and wild experiences and crazy puzzles that could only be possible using that unique set of weapons. And some of the jokes, it's like a machine gun. It's kind of like a Zucker Abrams Zucker movie where not every joke hits, but there's so many of them, so frequent that
I'm used to jokes not hitting. Don't
So, ain't that the truth? No.
You didn't even see rehearsals. It's rough out there.
So it was. I feel really proud of it. And the way to make that work, the way to save it, I had to. I didn't have to. I willingly and lovingly acquired it. Acquired the brand. And so when I did that, I wasn't thinking that the only goal is just to make sure that everyone can play Duke Nukem Forever. The real goal for me is I'd like to build a Duke Nukem game again.
Yeah.
And I'd like to, because I think what I would do and I think what Gearbox would do would be a little different, and I think it would be amazing, and I look forward to that.
Okay, great. Now, jumping off that for a little bit, what is it like to be Randy Pitchford now? You talk about how you started on this Duke Nukem game way back in the day, and now you were able to, your Gearbox is this super megalith. It's successful. Everybody loves it. You got Borderlands. Everybody loves it. You were able to come in and pick up this game that gave you your start and try to help out. It's been crazy, because I remember when Borderlands first got announced, the number one Borderlands there, it was like, oh, this is an interesting, weird, mainstreamed RPG.
A lot of people didn't think it was going
to
work.
Yeah, exactly. And now look at you. You're just laughing all the way to the blue bank.
I'm not laughing. Well, we obviously love, the intent behind Borderlands. That's obviously, we believed in it. We wouldn't have committed in it otherwise. And the fact that other people found it and found joy in it, it's like, that's why we fight. That's the dream, So we're living the dream. But, honestly, you asked me what it's like. I feel like I feel like I suck and I don't know shit. And we're just figuring. I feel like we're just figuring things out. I feel like we're just getting started. Like I've been playing a lot of Borderlands 2, for example. And I went back and played some Borderlands 1. And Borderlands 1 feels like the friggin' Stone Age compared to where. Like, it's crazy. Like, how much quality and everything we've learned, all the institutional knowledge and building on our systems and iterating and perfecting. It's kind of like I have an iPhone. And I had the first generation iPhone, and I've got an iPhone 4 now. And like, if you go back to the old one, even though it's the same form factor and it's the same kind of thing, it feels like slow and old. And like, but it was awesome when it happened, So I feel like what's the next thing is like really exciting and interesting to me. And I feel like that's what we need to keep our eye on. And there's just so much to do in this industry that we haven't even come close to exploring yet. That that's what keeps me up at night, is just dreaming about the future.
So right now my mom's watching this in Chicago, Illinois, Jamie Kennedy. She doesn't know what Borderlands is.
Okay.
So explain to somebody right now who's hearing about Borderlands for the first time, what is it? Why is Borderlands 2 going to be so great?
Borderlands is a game where a crazy psycho midget will run at you and you could punch his leg off.
Perfect. Pre-order now, Mom.
And take his stuff.
Yeah.
And take his stuff. And then use it to punch the next next.
Gotcha.
Yeah, it's wild. It's like, and the midget's on fire.
Okay. So, why did this find an audience? You talked about it, a lot of people didn't think Borderlands 1 was going to work, because it was this crazy, it's a first-person shooter RPG with 13,000 weapons that can be...
13,000.
Completely changed.
Oh, so humble. shooters are fun. It's fun. There's this, we have this kind of reptilian brain. Some people call it the reptilian brain, which kind of handles our primal motivations, like, you know, where we think like, oh, I need to eat that, or that's gonna kill me, avoid that, okay. Or like have sex with that, or, you know, whatever.
That's my favorite
no,
one.
No, it's like really like the most primal kind of instincts, right? And we have this like other, we've evolved into this kind of having this these intellectual capacities, you know, that have higher motivations, you know. There's, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of motivations and stuff. The shooter always kind of spoke to that primal kind of thing. It just feels good to kind of like move and aim and to jump and just shoot, and you get this feedback, and like, you know, just, and you can't even explain it, but like, just in this, the moment to moment play, it's just fun. It just, there's just something that's rewarding and feeling good about a shooter that's done really well. It's the best thing we've ever done. Like, wow. And it's not even close. It's not even close.
Is Claptrap back?
We almost fired him.
Oh, you can't fire Claptrap.
I know. Well, that's what he said. And he's a little, you know, he's a little pushy sometimes, but he's kind of a jerk. But you know, he's charming in his own way. So, yeah, he's around. Okay, he's around. Good, but he's on his last leg though. We got our eyes on
you're
him.
You watching him? All
right. One more misstep and right. He's out of there.
Of course, the game out next week. Yes. Review live on IGN, September 13th. Come to IGN.com, please.
And the game launches on the 18th.
Yeah, that's okay. But 13th is when you can come review. You made some headlines a while back. Borderlands and Vita started getting talked about together. Mm-hmm. What are you doing there? Is this happening? Because I would really like something to play on my
happened,
Vita.
What happened there? What happened there? Me too. I love my Vita. What I think is a really neat piece of hardware. We need games, and they know it. They've told us. So you know, Shu told us that you know he knows that we need to have more games on the platform. But I was at an event in London, in UK. It was in Brighton actually, on the beach, and we demonstrated Borderlands 2, and then I took some questions from the audience, and somebody said, hey. You know, what do you think about the Vita, and can we have Borderlands 2 on the Vita? And I said, I think that would be awesome. I think it would be awesome to have Borderlands 2 on the Vita. I said, I'm really busy, so like we can't do it ourselves, but if some other studio was capable and could be trusted by us and by a publishing partner and by Sony,
sure.
And someone wanted to invest in making that happen, like I think Sony should step up and make that happen. I don't think it would cost a lot, relatively speaking.
Yeah.
And I know there's a lot of talented people that have learned how to use the Vita that could do a great job at that. And I just wanted to say that if that machine started to align itself, I wouldn't be the holdup. I would actually be an enabler.
Gotcha.
But we don't have any effort. We don't have time. We can't afford it.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think it would be great, and I'd love to play. And what I'd love to do, like the dream scenario for me, would be, you know, I'm playing the game on my PS3. Imagine you could be playing the game on your PS3 and then like, okay, I have to go on a road trip or I have to go to work or something. And when I take my Vita with me, I have access to the same cloud save and I can continue my character. Can you imagine how amazing that would be?
I'm very much for this.
Can you imagine a world where like at E3 during their press conference, like Sony announced that was happening with Borderlands 2 and that like that we'd all be like, oh yeah,
yeah.
That is what the Vita is all about, right? That's like the promise realized. And but I love the Sony guys. In fact, I'm going to be meeting with them again soon, and we talk periodically, and maybe it'll come up.
Okay, yeah, make sure it comes up. I'm sure everybody out there wants this to happen. Right now, go ahead, Craig, put it up. Tweet at YoSP, that's Shuhei Yoshida. He's president of Sony Worldwide Studios. Tell him you'd like to see Borderlands 2 on the Vita, and he needs to talk to Randy over here and make it happen, and we'll have it.
She's a good guy.
She's a great guy. Yeah, yeah. Beating my butt at the treasure game on the Vita. Oh, yeah. He keeps sending me maps and just smoking me left and right. Yeah. Borderlands 2 is the cake that's done.
Dude.
September 18th.
It is, yeah, and you know
September 13th on IGN.com. Read about that.
you know what's neat about Borderlands 2 being, you know, imminent? There was so much momentum on the team, we didn't want to stop. So, you know, I'd already...
Borderlands 3, done.
We'd already announced that we added the ability to add new characters to the game as DLC, and we announced that the first one was going to be the Necromancer character, and we promised that if anyone already knows they're going to be a Borderlands 2 customer and they pre-order it, and they'll get the Necromancer character for free. That's going to be, we did announce that will be launched in mid-October, so it'll be about a month after the game comes out that the Necromancer will be available. It's still going to be free if you've pre-ordered it when it comes out. If you haven't pre-ordered it, it's going to be $10. Okay. But what's neat about it, what's different than when we first announced that and now is we got to work on it and build it, and it's freaking awesome. It's freaking awesome. It is, I'm so excited about this. And I love all the characters. In fact, you can go on IGN website.
Yeah,
I just spent some time walking through some details of the skill trees and some different build combinations that are cool. And so there's like different snippets for each of the four characters. Maybe I'll come back again and do it for the Necromancer soon. But man, she is just such a badass character and so awesome. And if you already know you want the game, just get it because pre-order it because then you don't have to pay and it's free if you do that. So get in there now. Mm. There's only a like around the corner. You can't. It won't be possible to pre-order it.
And so you'll
miss out. You'll miss out on the free thing. Right. And the fact that our publisher is offering that for free is just rad of them. You know, because again, to me, I just want everybody to play our stuff.
Yeah. So, well, I'm sure they will.
Awesome.
Randy, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so much. Cheers.
Don't go anywhere. Okay. I need your help here in a little bit.
Oh yeah.
Last week, the Oculus Rift, a hotly anticipated virtual reality headset, was funded on Kickstarter, and we at Up at Noon have a request for fans who would mod games for that sweet, beautiful headset.
Here is a real offer for Oculus Rift modders from Mike Drucker, Thousandaire! Do you mod video games? Do you want $100? Shut up and listen! I'm getting one of those Oculus Rifts pretty soon. Don't ask me where I got the money. All I'll say is that with your eyes closed, I'm just as good as any lady. Wink, wink, you get it. We make jokes here, not the point. Here's the point. I am so excited about virtual reality helping me escape the living hell that is everyday life that I am willing to pay you $100, that's 10,000 pennies, if you can mod any of the games in this list to use the Oculus Rift. Look at these games! But Mike, isn't $100 not a lot of money? Yes, IGN won't pay for this. I'm what's known as a loss leader for the company. They'll probably fire me soon and I'll have to move back in with my parents and my dad will be like, it's time for the belt again, Michael, and I'll be like, I'm a grown man, you can't do this to me, and he'll be like, grown men don't cry like little babies, take off your pants! And that's it for my offer! $100 for you if you mod one of the following games for the Oculus Rift. That's a whole trip to Olive Garden! IGN.com, the New York Post of video games. Call me Palmer Lucky.
What's up, everybody? As many of you might know, I have Hodgkin's lymphoma. It's cancer. Unfortunately, due to chemotherapy, I was losing my hair. But rather than just let it slowly fall out, I asked my good friend Randy Pitchford if he could go do the honors of shaving my head. So he got started.
Why not? Why not? Look, we've got something going on here. Are you ready for the big one?
Yeah, I'm ready for the big one.
You guys ready for this? Wow.
Let me see.
Isn't that amazing?
Oh yeah, looking good.
You want to do your exit while I finish this off?
Yeah, why not? If you enjoyed the show, please subscribe and leave a comment below. And please check out our other episodes and sketches. I'll be online the first hour this video is up responding to your comments. Thank you to my barber, Randy Pitchford. Yeah. Mike Drucker, Brian Altano, Anthony Gaius, Naomi Kyle, and the audience. Cheer for yourselves. If you want to be in that audience, go.ign.com/upatnoon for details. Also, thank you to Richard George from the Nintendo team. We borrowed his Leonardo statue without asking and he got really mad. We'll be back next week, Monday at noon. But until then, please send me hats at IGN, care of Greg Miller, 625 2nd Street, 3rd floor, San Francisco, California, 94107. Beyond.
Let me get this a little closer for you. Okay.
I just shit myself. And I shit myself. And I shit myself. And I shit myself. And I just shit myself. Oh my god, I made a pants poop. Oh, I shit myself. I keep shitting myself. What do you want from me?